on Tractate Nazir, page 42b, 8 lines from the bottom of the page. Just a little review of yesterday. We explain the concept of purity and ritual impurity, and we said that Nazir has the same category as Kohen Gadol, as the high priest, in a sense that Kohen Gadol, the Torah excluded him from contact anybody, excluding the seven immediate family, father, mother, brother, sister, son, daughter, and wife. The same applies to Nazir. The Torah used the term Ki Nezer Elokav al Rosho, that he is carrying the mandatory, the requirement upon his head. The mandatory requirement meaning he is prohibited to, in a case of death, contact. The exception are the seven immediate. The question is, we have to examine a lot of cases involved with ritual impurity. We explained yesterday a case like one when the coin carry, when the person carried on his shoulder a dead body, versus he contact to dead body toward another entity, which is the third. We explained that there is avi avot hatuma, the highest level of ritual impurity when someone contact directly, versus if it's toward something, which is again the third to be contact. We also explained yesterday a discussion about warning, hatraot, if they warn him once, if they warn him several times. And we said the example, if the Nazir is in the cemetery, we explained that the same problem with the Kohen enter to a cemetery, which will be part of our discussion, how you treated the Kohen that needs to go, for example, for the burial of his loved ones, but the cemetery have other ritual impurity of people who are not one of his seven. So in one hand, he wants to bury, for example, his father, but on the other hand, when he is out of the cemetery, he basically passed through graves that he prohibited to be in contact. Since, as you know, I'm dedicating the daf, the study, Le'ilui Nishmat, in memory of my late father, Harav Chaim Naftali ben Harav Yaakov Yitzchak Harini Kaparat Mishkavo. So it turns that I wasn't privileged to be at his funeral. My flight came there. It was already after burial, but I have heard that in Yerushalayim they have a very special minhag, which is they have all the eulogies before Chatzot, before the middle of the day, and then they buried. It was Erev Yontev, the eve of the holiday of Sukkot, so they buried after Chatzot. However, they not allow the immediate family to be present at the burial. That's the takana, the rules in Yerushalayim. So someone told me, he is not a halachic source, he's just a friend, so he can take it or leave it. He said one of the reasons he thinks it's because people who are not religious, and you said that if, for example, you are a Kohen, and you said, this is my father, and I want to be at the burial, but then you pass through a cemetery that have those whom you are not allowed to contact. So therefore, they put the boundaries, but I cannot assure that's correct. It's just a general takana in Yerushalayim that immediate family are not involved in the bury itself. So here we have to examine all the idea of tum'ah hadasha when it's come to chiburim, when it's come to a contact. The Meiri explained to us, and I'm just reading from the Rabbi Evan Israel Steinzel's a Koran translation of the Meiri, he said as follows: the concept of ritual impurity involve several different ways. One type is a person who touches a source of impurity while still in contact with another source of impurity. It means you attach directly to, for example, we explained yesterday, a body. A different category is that one who touches another who is in contact with a corpse. Apparently, these are two separate concepts which share a common name. So here you have the Mihiri that said that the Gemara asks a question, so we assume that the person, for example, if he hold in his hand the corpse, it's considered like impure item itself. So for example, consequently he cannot become impure again, and once he touches him has effectively touched the source of impurity itself. So here you see several issues of how you touch, how you treated attachment. Why? Because if it's not bechiburin, if it's not contact with the corpse, so it means that he let go of the corpse before he touched it again. We have here two different categories of ritual impurity. One is called tum'ah kala, a light manner of ritual impurity, which is just for that day until ha'arev shemesh, versus the other one that involved with the 7 days period, tum'ah bechiburin, meaning that the contact with the is still touching with the first corpse when he touches the second one, and therefore when it's come to that, it's a different idea, different concept, which is the 7 days period. So the Gemara said, we study today page 43, we start with 42b, 8 lines from the bottom of the page. So the Gemara asked, Vetum'a bechiburin deoraita? You mean to say that the ritual impurity, meaning the idea of contacting, the touching the first corpse when he touches the second one, is that a biblical? Ha amar Rav Yitzchak bar Yosef amar Rabbi Yanai, lo amru tum'ah bechiburim, ela lituma vekodashim. He said only when it's come to truma, meaning, as we explained many times, the a giving of truma, that they have a certain framework of what is right, and also the consecrated food, which means someone who touches a person who is in contact with a corpse is ritually impure with impurity imparted by the corpse for 7 days, which this is tum'ah chamura, it's the highest level of ritual impurity, versus, as we said, kala is just ad ha'erev, just that day. Aval lenazir, however, when it's come to Nazirite, ve'oseh Pesach, someone who involved with preparation of Paschal lamb, meaning if someone touch a dead body, he is ritually impure for 7 days. That applies to Truma and Kodashim, but it's not Stirat Nezirut, he's not losing the counting of the days because of that situation of ritual impurity. And also, when it's come to bringing the Paschal lamb, he's not ritually impure for 7 days, only up to the evening alone, and therefore he can bring his Paschal lamb within the framework of 7 days when he touches the corpse. Ve'i amart deoraita, if you tell me that this concept of tum'ah bechiburin is biblical, maishna, what's the reason that Rabbi Yanai differentiate between truma and kodashim and nazir and oseh pesach? Someone who touch a corpse, he needs to be ritually impure for all different dinim, and he cannot bring the paschal lamb And therefore, the whole time that he count for his nezirut is over. So you have to say that the tum'ah b'chiburin, the ritual impurity of touching the first corpse, it's only rabbinic, and that's opposite to what Rav Yosef said. So they said, no, you know what's happening here? Kan b'chiburei adam be'adam. You have to say that this applies when one person, let's call him a name, Reuven, and contact to the other one with Shimon, while the later, the Shimon is touching a corpse. So therefore, what happened here? You have here the third person, he's not ritually impure for 7 days, for those concepts of Tumah and Kodashim, by the biblical term, but only the rabbinic, meaning, the Rosh explained, biblically speaking, is only that day until the sunset. Rabbinically speaking, it's 7 days period of ritual impurity.
But that's only from Av Tumah, though.
Yeah, but the idea is because you have a subsequent order.
No, I understand, but the 7 days is specifically for Av Tumah.
7 days is any contact. Direct contact, yes. Yeah, it's so the severe, Tumah, right? Yes. Okay, yeah. Yeah, okay. Or in a sense, contacting and become Avi Avot HaTumah.
Right.
Avi Avot,
right.
Meaning direct. Anyway, Kan, in the view of Rav Yosef, Bechiburei Adam Bemet, involved with touching the corpse. So this one is 7 days, biblically speaking. So therefore, Tum'ah Bechiburin, if it's direct contact, the first corpse is biblical. And Rav Yosef differentiate between the tum'ah bechiburin, the first corpse, tum'ah shelo bechiburin, which is the one that he let go of the corpse before he touched it again, and the difference between that is the liability of receiving malkot for that ritual impurity. So now Gemara asks a question: Aval tum'ah ve'tum'ah lo? You mean to say that if Nazir contact a ritual impurity when he from a corpse, and then contacted a ritual impurity a second time by means of other than roof association, he is not liable for two transgressions, the ha mitame vekaim, because presumably the Nazir is not liable for contacting Tumah the second time because he's already ritually impure. Tum'ah ubi'ah nami. So it's also when he is ritually impure from a corpse and then contacts a ritual impurity a second time by entering a roof of building that contains a corpse, he shall not be liable for two transgressions. Ha mitame vekae, because he enters the house, he is already a ritual impure. If you remember, yesterday we explained that there are three different concepts of ritual impurity. One of them is just the building, that they carry the same roof, that already carries the ritual impurity, that one who enters has basically received the contamination of ritual impurity. So they said, Amar Rabbi Yochanan, Rabbi Yochanan explains, you know what's the difference? Kan, the situation of Tum'ah Ubi'ah, that is both bebait, which means the house. Nazir is not tameh when he entered a house that contained a corpse. In such a case, he's entering into the house and he has a defilement occurred simultaneously. So here you have two different transgressions, meaning he is liable of two sets of malkot, kan besadeh, meaning the first one, the way that Rabbi Meir Simcha explains, that the condition is that they have to warn him, the Rosh said it too, they have to warn him two times. Kan, when you have a tum'ah and tum'ah, which means it's only one time, is besadeh, which means that you don't have a roof at the top. So if a Nazir enter to that place, that they it's like a tent that the corpse there, since there's no roof, we treat it differently. There's only one, And therefore, he received Malkot only one time. Page 43. Bevayit name is no additional when he entered the house to Kevan dea el yadei istaev. The moment he enter, meaning he pull his hand inside, even the entire body is not there, he is already ritual impure. The Rosh explained that philosophically or in a general term, hypothetically, even he just pull his hand in and not the entire body, were already halachically considered as he was there, physically touched. Ki ayel kulehai tamehu, which means if we entire body enter to the house, it's not additional tum'ah by that entering. So why he is in a violation of two transgressions, lo yitama and lo yavo, ela amar Rabbi Elazar tzeiraf yado, meaning he pulled his hand and entered to a house that is a dead body, and then he entered with his entire body, mishum tum'ah ika, mishum bi'ah leika. You have here a concept of ritual impurity, but you do not have the bi'ah, the entrance, which means he is liable only because he contaminated to a corpse, but is not liable for entering the tent that the dead body is there, because he is already earlier ritually impure. Vetzeiraf gufo, and he extended his body, which means he held his hands next to his sides as he entered. So therefore, tum'ah uvi'ah bahadei hadadei ka'atu, contamination and entry occur simultaneously. So therefore, he's liable for both. So Gemara rejects and said, ha'i efshar delo ayel chotmo bereisha. The reality is that it's impossible that his nose should not enter fields. Soon you see, we count all the 248 organs in the body, and we're going to have a series of understanding how far when it's come to those allowance of touch. El amarava echnis, there's a few versions. Some said yado, some said rosho, his hand, his head, mishum tuma ika, mishum be'alea leika, for contaminating himself but not entering. So he said, so the Gemara rejected. Impossible to have the toe should not enter first, which means so it's already, you have the contamination descend upon him before he enters the house. So the Tosfot and the Rosh said, you can't say someone who go backward. Why? Because that's not considering a regular manner, derech bi'ah, that people entering the domain. So Rav Papa said, Amar Rav Papa, kogon shenichnas beshida teiva umigdal. You have to say that he enter a chest, a box, or a cabinet, which are not susceptible to ritual impurity, and which protect the contents from impurity when they can held more than 40 se'ah. Uba chaveiro, and another fellow came in, upara alav et hama'aziva, and opened the cover of the vessel from over him. So is no longer a partition between nazir and the ritual impurity. So here you have the simultaneously of both. Another option, Mar Baravashi Amar, the reason that he received two Malkiyot for the ritual impurity and for entering the domain that is a corpse, Kegon de Ayel Kshehu Goses, when someone enter when the other is dying, is not dead, but is in a reach of this. So even the Gemara said that Rov Gosesim Lemita, that most of the people who are about to die eventually will die. But since he's not dead, so for sure, if it's a regular healthy person, it's not an issue for Nazir to enter to that domain. And he doesn't have a concern that maybe he passed. So even the warning is nothing. But if it's Gosses, someone who's dying, and we assume that it happened, we just know, we have no idea when, the Nazir automatically is prohibited from entering there. And then when we warn him, do not enter, then he enter, and that person who's dying pass, he deserve Malkot. That's the way the Rosh and Kirnua explains. So they said, V'nafak nishmatei adeyativ. So he passed when the Nazir was there. The Tumah ubi'ah bahade ka'adi ka'atyan. So here you have ritual impurity and entering the enclosure with the corpse occurs simultaneously. So since there was no corpse in the enclosure when he entered, he is considered to have entered an enclosure with the corpse at the moment the person died. So from this response of Marba Ravashi, we understand that the person who is dying is not contaminated until he departed, the soul departed from his body. So Tanu Rabbanan, the Torah speaks about the law of ritual impurity when it's involved with the Kohanim. Leviticus 21, verse 4. Lo yitama leheichalo. Lo yitama ba'al be'amav leheichalo. Rashi explains there, which means, as long as that the Kohen is be'amav, which means that she have other people who can bury her, so therefore is not considering a met mitzvah for him to bury his wife. But leheichalo, meaning that she's the wife that is psula, it's not befitting. So therefore, it's considering a desecration of his priesthood, the sanctity of his priesthood. So meaning, if it's a regular man of husband-wife, so it's not an issue, right? The only issue is a psilut. But anyway, they said leheichalo, you derive it from the word halal. You remember we talk about halalut. Halalut meaning if a Kohen, for example, have relation by any means with someone that is prohibited by the Torah, the result, the child that come out of that union is no longer Kohen. It's called halal, right? So therefore, so ad sha'a sheyamut. Until that person pass and he become halal. In France, a friend of mine is a rabbi in France, he told me that in the Orthodox shuls, some of them, they examine the Kohanim before they come up to the Bima and blessings. And they have some people who even have the name of Kohen or name of Katz, Kohen Tzedek. They check, and if something is not 100% clear, the Gabaim not allow them to come up on the Bima and bless.
We do in Israel too, right?
In Israel, some places too.
Or they get to check.
For example, you have a fellow that marry a convert or divorce that the Torah not allow him, right? For example, someone who claimed that he is a Kohen, and when you examine, it turns that his parents, his mother marry his father after she divorced from the first husband.
Even though
more and or right.
Most of them usually know.
All right. So the point is, some people who not raise properly, meaning they are just uneducated, and you start asking questions and examining, you discover a lot of things. So that's the reason why some shuls.
People even in our shul that are.
Oh, don't go there. All right.
Right. So, yeah, that's.
All right. Rabbi Omer, Rabbi said, in regards to the prohibition for Nazir to become ritually impure, Book of Bamidbar, chapter 6, verse 7, they have a list, le'aviv, le'imo, le'achiv, le'achoto, the father, mother, brother, sister, lo yitama lahem bemotam. So what does that mean? Bemotam yitama, ad shiyamut. Mai bena, yom Rabbi Yochanan, mashma'ut dorshin, Ika menayu. So it's no different in halacha. The only difference is the someone who's gosses, he's dying, is not contaminated. The only how you treated the leichalo tana kama hold that the Nazir and the Quran warn. Rabbi said bemotam. You derive it from the word bemotam. So there's a big discussion. Kiran Orai and others said that if you tell me that a dying person is not carry ritual impurity, so why you need the pasuk? Anyway, Resh Lakish amar goses ika benayu. Leman de'amar leichalo afilu goses. Leman de'amar bemotam adi amut ein goses lo. Here you have to differentiate. The one who said the sources beleichalo, even the person's dying, they are warned. Why? As we said, because most of the people who are dying, eventually, sooner or later, you don't know if it's another 30 seconds or another 30 minutes, or even a day, but eventually they die. So therefore, you use the term halal for the goses, for dying person. According to Rebbe, that he said that the derivative is from the word bemotam, in their death, ad shiamut in goses lo. So they have to say until the they die, but as long as he's not dead, his goses, it's not worn. Uleman damar leichalo aktiv bemotam, and the one who said leichalo, the Torah used the word bemotam, so they said mibaylech de Rabbi, the Tanya Rabbi Omer bemotam eno metame, aval metame benigatam ubezivatam, which means the Nazir may not contaminate himself to them, but upon their affliction with tzarat or ziva, he may contaminate himself with them while they are still alive. So they said, ולמאן דאמר במותם המבייל אלא הסברה, אם כן למקרא במות, מהי במותם שמת מינה תרתי. So you derive from them two things that the from this verse. So from the addition of the letter mem at the end, you learn another drasha that he's not warning of ritual impurity, good morning, until the person passed away, the person who touched it passed away. Uleman de'amar b'motam aktiv leichalo, but according to Rebbe, who says that the law defined the onset of ritual impurity is derived from in their death, so it's written leheichalo, to profane himself. So how the Rebbe derive from this pasuk? Leichalo le'ach yudata b'mi she'no mechulal, which means someone who's not carry the ritual impurity of a dead. By the way, that's for you, the session today, because you are born Kohen and you are pure Kohen, right? Kosher Kohen.
And a Shomer Shabbos Kohen.
And Shomer Shabbos Kohen. So there's a lot of things involved with you. We're sorry you're not here early, so you hear all the things we talk about you, but it was all good. Yes.
Like the Nasir and the Kohen, if their parents die, they can't go to the cemetery, right? They got to.
What?
Well, talking I didn't about ask. The seven relatives of the Kohen, specifically the seven relatives. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That's when they're allowed. That's when they're allowed. Yeah,
the Kohen. But we mentioned the Chatam Sofer. The problem is when after burial, if they go, if they are not educated, you know, the problem is they can pass by other graves who are not seven immediate family.
That's the issue.
But in Asir, if he go, he won't have to break it. He won't have to start all over again.
He has to.
What would he say?
And as a Nazir, they have to start the term over again.
If the Nazir
in some case, we said that Sotel.
Yeah. And that's.
But there's an argument if the Kohen, or isn't there an argument who has to keep the Nazir, the Kohen or the Nazir? There's difference of opinion.
Okay, so we learn page 42b. If you remember, the disputation between Rabbi and Rav Yosef, if you remember. That if you're talking about every case of Kohen Tmemet, or only if he carries on his shoulder a dead body, so that not additional ritual impurity with the second Tum'ah, but here we said, Uleman da'amar leheichalo, meleheichalo, hami baile lehai svara, so that Kohen cannot go back and carry ritual impurity. In Ken Lema קרא להחל, מי להיכלו, שמה מינה תרתי. So because they use the word להיכלו to profane himself, you have these both laws together. Meaning from the additional letter Vav at the end of the word להחל, להיכלו, with Vav at the end, that the Kohen is not warned of any ritual impurity of a person until he is total deceased. Not when he is gosses, when he's dying. Meitivei. So here we challenge that from Mishnah and Tractate Aholot, the first chapter, Mishnah number 6. Adam et no metame ad sheteitze nafsho. This is a very important statement. They say that a person renders other impure only when his soul departs from him. Va'afilu meguyad. Even if he has severe part of the body is cut. Like it just happened yesterday in Yerushalayim, people stabbed left and right? Even by female terrorists, right? Mm-hmm. Crazy. So they use sometimes a butcher knives. So imagine you have a body there that is cut all over. Since it's still breathing, they still pulse, so it's not carry ritual impurity. ואפילו גוסס, meaning even he's dying, but he's not totally dead. ולמאן דאמר מי להיכלו, according to the first Tana, that said that you derive from להיכלו, that Kohen and Nazir warn for the גוסס, הקטני דאינו מטמא. So they said, לעינן תמויה דנפקי נפשי, until his soul departed. לעינן התחול לה התחיל. 43b. So, as we said, there is a concept of seven immediate family. Leviticus 21. אמר רב חסדא אמר רב, נקטע ראשו של אביו. If his father's head was cut off, meaning the Kohen, אינו מטמא לו. מה הייתה אמר? אמר קרא, the פסוק said, לאביו, בזמן שהוא שלם, ולא בזמן שהוא חסר. Meaning, not when any part of the body is missing. If the body is not whole, he's not considered, quote-unquote, his father, but rather part of him, and therefore the prohibition on contacting Tuma applied to him. אמר לרב אמנון אלא מעתה כזיל בפקטה דערבות. For example, if the Kohen walks in traveling in the bears of the ערבות, ופסקו הגן ולרישה, and you have those robbers that cut off his head. אכן עמד לא לתמלה, you mean to say that his son cannot contaminate to him? אמר למת מצווה כאמרת. You're asking about מת מצווה, which is unattended corpse. That all the rules changed. Now you said that the Kohen is obligated to contaminate himself for the burial. So for sure, if it's father, how much so? But is this a really met mitzvah? That the Kohen can contaminate to him. As long as there's no people, others who can bury him. ואחרים עונים אותו, אין זה מת מצווה. But if he can call, or if other answer for assistance, and other will answer him, so and attend to the burial, so this is not case of unattended corpse, and the Kohen is forbidden to contaminate himself. So they said, והאיתלה ברא, so we derive from the story of Kohen Bikat Arvod that he can hire others to take care of burial. Kevan de azil beorcha kimi she'en lo kovrin dami. Since he's traveling on the road and there is nobody else in the vicinity, the dead man is comparable to one who has no burials. So meitivei. The Torah said la itama. So the relative of the Kohen that he can contaminate them. So la. The full body of his sister, who metameh ve'no metameh le'evareha. But if he's cutting part of her body, he cannot contaminate. Lefi shelo metameh le'ever min ha'chai shel aviv. Because he, the Kohen, may not even contaminate himself with the limb that was severed from the live body of his father. That's the most closest to him. Aval machaziru al etzem kis'ora. But he may return to the place that he died from a bone, the size of even a barley grain that was left behind, which means when it's come to this ritual impurity, even that side. So there is a famous responsa from the rabbi of Padua. He brought Rabbi Akiva Iger that said that if you have a concern that maybe the doctor start tempting with the body after the pass, and you worry that they're going to use it for science or other purposes, you're allowed to contaminate yourself, even you are Kohen, to pull out the body from that location. It's a famous responsa. Anyway, my machaziru al etzem kisora, lav lemimradim machasar purta, which means that part of the dead body is missing, the sand can bury it. So he said, lo, hai Rabbi Yudai, that he allowed Kohen to contaminate to his father's body, even some of these bodies missing. Rav Chisda hold that the Kohen cannot touch to the dead body of his father when he's not complete dead body. So that's basically follow the rule of Chachamim, the sages that disputed Rabbi Yudah. The Tanner, Rabbi Yudah Omer, La, the body of his sister, Mitameh, the Kohen can contaminate it. Ve'no mitameh le'evareah, if it's a part of her body was cut, right? You watch on the news yesterday, right? The terrorists came and stabbed people and cut part of the body in Yerushalayim. So in that case, if part of the body is already not considering quote-unquote a total body, here the Kohen cannot touch that part. She'eno mitameh al ever min hachai shel aviv, even a living part of his father, aval mitameh le'ever min hamet shel aviv, after he's no longer alive. There is a total different category for those limb. V'atanya, I wish to have more time. V'atanya Rav Kahana be Rabbi Eliezer ben Yaakov, he said, La metameh, ve'no metameh le'evarim, part of the body that departed, part the kezait minamen, minamet, uchzait netzel, umelo tarvad rakav. So here we talk about a size. He said the olive volumes of netzel and a lead full of corpse dusts. So he said, Yachol lo itama leshidra ulgolgolet ulerov binyana ulerov minyana. So you may say that it's the now you measure the skeleton, you measure the body. How you measure it? So you go by the 248, you have 225 bones of the body. That's the majority of the 248 bone, the Rosh said, of a dead body. So here we see differentiation between these two categories, how you count each part of the limb of the body. Ktiv ve'amarta lehem, the Torah said in Leviticus 21, that Vayomer Hashem el Moshe, God spoke to Moses, Emor la Kohanim bnei Aaron, speak to the Kohanim, sons of Aaron, ve'amarta lehem, to dispel the notion, it's written, and you shall say to them. So what does that mean? Lenefesh lo itama be'amar, hosif lecha ha'katuv tumra acheret, which means the verse, the scripture, adds for you another tameh, with which a Kohen is permitted to become tameh from his sister. Yachol, page 44. Yachol lo itama leshidra ulegulgolet ulerov binyano ulerov minyano. One might have thought that he may not become impure to bury a spine or for a skull or to bury most of the skeleton or most of the number of bones of other relatives for whom a Kohen becomes impure. So they said, Amad ma'achotom yuchedet shegufat lu yavbo, that she depend on him, the sister, is unique. The body depend on him, the brother tending to her burial. Mitameh leshidra ulgugolet v'rov b'dyana ulgom b'dyana. So therefore, he can become ritually impure to bury a spine, or bury a skull, or bury most of her skeleton, or bury most of her number of bones. So too, you see here, afkol shegufot alu ibo mitameh leshidra ulgulgolet l'rov binyano l'rov binyano. The same here, we say every person whose body is dependent upon him, which means his other close relatives, he become impure to bury a spine, or bury a skull, or bury most of this his skeleton, or bury most of his number of bones. So this presents a difficulty for the opinion of Rav, that the Kohen may not become impure to bury any relative whose head has not been severed. Ahi name Rabbi Yudai, v'Rav de'amar ki haitana de'tanya, ma'aseh shemet aviv shel Rabbi Yitzchak beGinzak. They bring a story to teach us an important lesson. Ginzak, they said that it was a North Israel, it's high north, they call it Ginzak Shel Madai, it's far high north. So here the story, 3 years after the father passed away, they come and inform him that the father passed. So he have now a notion, he wants to open the grave, transfer the body of his father from the place that he was there to Eretz Yisrael. Now, the problem is that Rabbi Yitzchak was a Kohen. So v'shalet Rabbi Yoshua ben Elisha v'arba azkenim she'imo. He asked these rabbis, this elder, if he can contaminate to the body of his father in order to transfer from his place of burial to the Kivrei Avot, because there are some exceptional halacha when you're allowed to open a grave and transfer. The Shulchan Aruch Yoreh De'ah Shin Samech Gimel 363 said, for example, if a person wants to be buried in Israel, or nowadays, if it's a desecration of cemetery, etc., there are some exceptions. In general, we're not allowed to open graves. So he asked, can I do that? Why? The problem is that it's already 3 years passed by, and the idea is that the body decay during that time. It's not a total dead body. So therefore, can I contaminate as a Kohen to the dead body of whatever left over from of my father? So ve'amru, so they tell him, based on Leviticus 21, verses 1 and 2, u le'aviv bizman shehu shalem ve'lo bizman shehu chaser. That's applied to his father as long as the whole body of his father is a whole, but when it's a missing a part, so you cannot contaminate yourself. So that's basically the Rambam tells us in Chol Tavelut, chapter 2, and it's also the code, Yoreh De'ah, Shin Ayin Gimel 373. He says that Kohen cannot contaminate to a missing part of his dead father's dead body. However, the Meiri and other disputed and said that in some cases he can do it. And there's a famous question they ask, for example, the Shevet HaLevi, the Rav Vozner, how you treated Baal Tshuva Kohen? Can he touch the body of parents who are in violation of Torah law? Or the question they asked the Chatam Sofer, they found a matzeva, they found a monument that dated 450 years earlier. So they ask, is the Kohanim allowed to pass by that location? Why? Because the assumption is that the body is already decayed, is 450 years passed by, so is still carry the ritual impurity or not, since you don't know who and what buried there and how they buried there. There are some notion of, for example, Rabbi Elimelech of Lizhensk. They said that when the Nazis desecrate cemeteries, so they went to his graveside, and the story goes, I read it in a few books, that they opened the grave, and the officers noticed that the body is like he just passed away. And he was so shocked, he ran away, shocked, and with a great fear, because he never saw something like that. So since we don't know clearly the state of the decay of that body, therefore we have the assumption that some of the body is missing because it's decay. So therefore that's the notion of the code that said in 373 chapter not to do that. But again, if it's a practical halacha, you have to ask a prominent rabbi. Shut up.